Who are the 24 elders? In Revelation chapter 4, the Apostle John tells us that he saw a curious group of persons sitting around the throne of God in heaven. He calls them elders and says that there were exactly 24 of them. Were these elders literal heavenly beings, or did they just symbolize someone or something else? Let's examine what the Bible says about these elders and see if we can determine who they are. Here's what we know. They're found in chapter 4, sitting around the throne of God, wearing white robes with crowns on their heads. Then, later in chapter 4, these elders are found falling down, worshiping God, and casting their crowns before the throne. In chapter 5, when no one is found worthy to open the book with seven seals, it is one of these 24 elders who speaks to John, saying, "Weep not, behold, the Lion of the tribe of Judah, the Root of David, hath prevailed to open the book." Then, the elders fall down before the Lamb of God, singing, "Thou art worthy to take the book and to open the seals thereof. For thou wast slain, and hast redeemed us to God by thy blood out of every kindred and tongue and people and nation, and hast made us unto our God kings and priests, and we shall reign on the earth." Then in chapter 7, it is again one of the elders who speaks to John and reveals to him information on a massive crowd of innumerable people that John saw in heaven. This crowd of people were also wearing white robes, and they had palms in their hands. These, the elder tells John, have come out of great tribulation, and they have washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb. So, here's a couple of things we know about these elders. They sit around the throne of God, they wear white robes, they have golden crowns until they cast them before the throne, they sing that the Lamb has redeemed them to God by his blood out of every kindred, tongue, and people and nation, and they apparently are not the same as those wearing white robes with palms in their hands who came out of great tribulation. So, what does this mean? Who are the elders? Well, you might already be drawing some conclusions about who you think these elders are. Here's the two most popular theories, along with their strengths and weaknesses. Many people think that these elders are just angelic beings that God created to sit around his throne and praise him. This is the position held by people like the self-proclaimed prophet Kat Kerr, who claims she's been to heaven hundreds of times and that she's met the elders and that they are just angelic beings.
And there are the 24 elders. Sometimes they're on their thrones. Sometimes they're out in heaven wanting to serve you. And they are not the leaders of the 12 tribes of Israel. They are not the disciples. These are created ancient beings that have always been with the Father.
This claim seems to be a reasonable explanation until it is carefully examined. Think about it. Angels are mentioned throughout the Bible from Genesis to Revelation. There are mentions of the strange-looking cherubim with four wings, the seraphim with six wings, and other angelic messengers that look human. But never are they called elders. These elders are only mentioned in the book of Revelation, and when they are mentioned, they seem to be distinct from the angels, as we see in chapter 5, where scripture speaks of angels and beasts and the elders. This suggests that they are not angels, otherwise why would they say angels and the elders, right? Not only that, but whenever elder is used in scripture, it always refers to a respected leader, never to an angelic being. And what's more is that angels are never seen with crowns on their heads. Angels don't rule anything. They are servants of God. And that leads us to the second theory about these elders, that they are actually a representation of believing saints of God. Paul writes in 1 Corinthians 6 that we, the believers, shall judge angels, and the book of Revelation itself tells us that it is believers who will live and reign with Christ. So when the elders say of the Lamb in chapter 5 Thou hast redeemed us to God by thy blood, and hast made us unto our God kings and priests, and we shall reign on the earth. It sounds like this proves that they are not angels. In fact, I think that this is absolute proof that these elders are believing saints. Most people don't realize that when John wrote the book of Revelation to the church in the first century AD, he took a quote from the song that the elders sing in chapter 5 and used it as his introduction in chapter 1. As John was inspired to write this book, he indicated that this song is about you and me as believers. In chapter 5, the elders sang that they were redeemed unto God by the blood of the Lamb, and were made kings and priests to God, and would reign with Christ on the earth. And in chapter 1, John wrote specifically to the seven churches, saying that Christ loved us and washed us from our sins in his own blood, and hath made us kings and priests unto God and his Father. It seems abundantly clear that John intended to convey to the church that this song that the elders sang was about Christians, but the elders said that it was about them. How can this be unless the elders are the Christians? Also, notice what John writes to the churches in chapters 2 and 3. He writes in chapter 2, verse 10, saying that if the church was faithful unto death, Jesus told them, I will give thee a crown of life. In verse 26, Jesus promises the church that he that overcometh, to him will I give power over the nations. To the church of Sardis in chapter 3, verse 5, Jesus promised, he that overcometh, the same shall be clothed in white raiment. Then in verse 11, Jesus warns the church in Philadelphia not to let anyone steal their crown. Finally, to the church of Laodicea, Jesus counsels them to buy of him white raiment and promises that to him that overcometh will I grant to sit with me in my throne. So the churches are promised in chapters 2 and 3 that they will receive crowns, white robes, and a seat with God around his throne. And immediately afterward, in Revelation chapter 4, we find 24 elders sitting with God before his throne, wearing white robes and having crowns. This is pretty convincing if you ask me. And these promises are not just in the book of Revelation. In at least three other places in the Bible, in 2 Timothy 4, James 1, and 1 Peter 5, Christians are promised crowns for living in obedience to Christ. And though angels are often seen wearing white robes, only the believers are promised a seat with God around the throne. Also, another compelling evidence that these are not angels is found in their song, when they claim that they have been redeemed to God out of every kindred and tongue and people and nation. Jesus didn't die to redeem angels, and angels weren't redeemed out of the world of human people and nations. But I admit that while all of this seems abundantly clear, there are three big questions that I have not yet answered about these elders. If they are human saints, why are they different from the other believers with white robes and palms in their hands in chapter 7? And if their song in Revelation chapter 5 proves that they are humans, why does the Bible seem to tell us that the angelic beasts around the throne of God also sing that same song? And thirdly, why are there 24 of them? Surely there will be more than 24 believers in heaven. So what is the significance of the number 24 here? Let's tackle these questions one at a time. First, if they are human, why are they different from those who came out of the Great Tribulation in chapter 7? Well, this answer is actually pretty simple if you are a futurist. That is to say, if you believe that Revelation is giving us a prophecy of things that have not yet happened, they will happen in the future. The futurist position here makes perfect sense. If the final 7 years of prophecy that Daniel wrote about in Daniel chapter 9 is going to happen in the future, And if there is going to be a great tribulation during those 7 years, as Jesus said in Matthew 24:21, then we can reason that those that die and go to heaven during this period of great tribulation are the massive number of people in white robes that John saw in heaven in Revelation 7. In Revelation 6, John tells us that the souls of those who die during this time of tribulation are seen in heaven and are given white robes. So apparently the 24 elders are saints that are in heaven before this great tribulation begins. Because once it begins, the souls who die and go to heaven are not part of these elders. They don't have crowns. They don't have a seat around the throne. They're actually found beneath the altar. But they are given white robes. In fact, if the elders are saints, it seems that they are resurrected saints, or believers with new bodies. I say that because those who die during the tribulation aren't seen in heaven with bodies. It is only their souls that are seen in heaven, and then after Jesus returns in chapter 19, chapter 20 tells us that the souls of those who lived during this great tribulation were resurrected after the return of Christ. This fits a futurist view of a pre-tribulation rapture of the saints. That is, since the elders seem to be saints, and specifically not saints from the tribulation, and since the elders have already received their crowns or rewards that Jesus promised them at the resurrection, it seems that these elders were resurrected or raptured before the tribulation began. And then after the tribulation, all those believers who died during that time are resurrected too. This explains why, in between the beginning and end of this great tribulation, those who are already resurrected are called the 24 elders, and those who die and go to heaven during this time but are not resurrected yet are called souls in heaven. This is at least the most fitting explanation that I can see, and it harmonizes all of the book of Revelation and makes perfect sense without having to twist the scripture to make it fit. All right, but if we're right about this, and if the song of the elders proves that they are believers who have been resurrected, then why does Revelation 5 tell us that the four beasts and 24 elders fell down before the Lamb and sang this song? If these are angelic beasts and they sang this song, doesn't it prove that the elders could also be angelic beings? Well, first of all, it doesn't actually say that the beasts sang this song. It says that the beasts fell down with the 24 elders. And then it says that every one of them had harps and golden vials full of odors, which John writes are the prayers of the saints. Now, since they are about to sing a song proving that they are saints, it's reasonable to assume that it was the elders who had the harps and golden vials. The elders, who seem to be the saints, would be the ones offering the prayers of the saints, right? So maybe it was only the elders who had the vials. And if it was only the elders who had these golden vials, then the next phrase about them singing the song would also only have been the elders. Maybe the beasts fell down in worship, but only the elders had the vials and sang the song. What I'm saying is that the wording of this verse doesn't tell us that the beasts necessarily sang the song. All we know is that they fell down with the elders. But regardless of that, even if the beasts did sing along with the elders, that song would have to be true for at least one of the groups singing it, right? I mean, we know the beasts weren't saints. So since they sang that God had redeemed them through his blood, surely it would have had to be true about the elders, right? If it wasn't true about the beasts or the elders, it would be nonsensical. So what if the beasts did sing a harmony along with the elders here? That wouldn't prove that this song wasn't true about the elders, would it? I don't think so. But it's also likely that they didn't sing. Finally, let's ask the big question. Why are there only 24 elders seen in heaven? If they are saints, shouldn't there be a lot more of them? Well, since we can say with good confidence that these elders are representative of believers who lived before the Great Tribulation, we can make a few easy guesses as to what the number 24 symbolizes. 24 is actually a very rare number in Scripture, and this seems to make our answer easier to find. Because while 24 is hardly found, the number 12 is found over and over again. Chiefly, the 12 sons of Jacob and the 12 apostles of Jesus Christ. Now, since this number 12 is found to refer to two different groups, we can posit a theory. What if both of these groups were found together in one place at one time? How many would there be then? Well, 12 plus 12 equals 24, of course, which leads to the theory that the number 24 speaks of believers from the Old and New Testaments. Believers before Jesus died on the cross may be represented by the 12 tribes of Israel, and believers after the cross may be represented by the 12 apostles, and together they are the 24 elders. This makes sense, and it fits with the meaning of the word elder, which is a respected leader, especially an older man. The 24 elders may be the 24 leaders of God's people from the Old and New Testaments. But admittedly, this is just a theory. We must find some scriptural support for this idea before we can assume that it is actually a good explanation for the number 24. Here's two passages to consider. Revelation 21 and Matthew 19. In Revelation 21, we see a description of the New Jerusalem, the city of God, descending out of heaven. The city is bright and made of clear gold and looks like crystal, and John tells us that it has 12 gates and 12 foundations. The 12 gates, he says, had names written on them, the names of the 12 tribes of Israel. And the 12 foundation stones, well, they also had names written on them, the names of the 12 apostles. This seems to confirm my theory. The New Jerusalem is for all believers from all times, both before and after the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. And this is signified by two sets of 12, 12 tribes of Israel and 12 apostles. Add them together and you get 24. And that's not all. Check out Matthew 19, where we read another very curious statement made by Jesus himself. He said to Peter, "Ye which have followed me in the regeneration when the Son of Man shall sit in the throne of his glory, ye also shall sit upon 12 thrones, judging the 12 tribes of Israel." Now, this might refer to the judging of nations that saints will participate in after the 7-year tribulation period, but it's interesting to see these two groups of 12 again mentioned. It's reasonable to assume that the first group here, the 12 apostles, can represent all believers in the church in the same way that the second group, the 12 tribes, can represent all of Israel. Taking all of this evidence together, I think we have a rock-solid case for thinking that the 24 elders symbolize resurrected saints from all time, before and after Jesus walked the earth, and that this actually proves that saints are resurrected before the last 7 years of prophecy begin and the Great Tribulation comes to those remaining on the earth. Now, I know a lot of people disagree with me on my view that the rapture will take place before the tribulation, and that's okay. I want to know your theories about the 24 elders. Are they really just angelic beings? If so, how do you explain their crowns in chapter 4 or their song in chapter 5? And if they really are a picture of believers, doesn't that prove the pre-tribulation rapture? Let me know what you think in the comments below. Now, before I go, I want to sincerely thank you for watching this video. If you like this content, don't forget to hit subscribe to support the channel and to see more content like this. And follow The Bible Explained on Facebook at facebook.com/TheBibleExplained. I really appreciate the support. Also, I want to remind you that the entire Bible is ultimately about one thing, the redemption of mankind by Jesus Christ. You see, the Bible tells us that all men are sinners, and that we must pay for our sin against God for eternity in hell. That's definitely the bad news. But you see, the Bible is all about this one thing, the good news that Christ died to pay the penalty for our sin on the cross. Since your sin has been paid for by Christ, all that is left for you to do is to turn from your sin and accept His salvation by faith. If you've never accepted this gift of God by faith, won't you do that today? Leave a comment or send me a private message on Facebook, and I'll be happy to talk to you more about having your sins forgiven by Jesus Christ.